Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm Valentina Novak, a research fellow in urban planning at the University of Trieste. In this presentation, I will provide just a brief overview of the seven principles of universal design. The principles were developed by Ronald Mace and his team, a group of architects, product designers, engineers, and environmental design researchers, in 1997 at the Center for Universal Design at North Carolina State University. According to the center, the principles may be applied to guide the design process of environments, products, and communications. Moreover, they may be applied also to evaluate existing designs and educate both the designers and consumers about the characteristics of more usable products and environment. There are seven principles that the Center for Universal Design developed. The first one is equitable use. The design needs to be useful and marketable to people with diverse abilities. Flexibility in use, the second one. The design accommodates a wide range of individual preferences and abilities. The third principle is simple and intuitive use. The use of the design needs to be easy to understand, regardless of the user's experience, knowledge, language skills, or current concentration level. The fourth principle is perceptible information. The design communicates necessary information efficiently to the user, regardless of ambient condition or the user's sensory abilities. Principle number five is tolerance for error. The design minimizes hazards and the adverse consequences of accidental or unintended actions. The principle number six is low physical effort. The design can be used efficiently comfortably, and with a minimum of effort. The seventh principle, the last one, is size and space for approach and use. It means appropriate size and space provided for approach, reach, for manipulation, for use, regardless of the user's body size, postures, or mobility. So, in the next slides, we go into more detail on each principle. We will look at this definition and the guidelines provided by the Universal Design Center and a little example. So, for the first principle, that is equitable use, the guidelines are provide the same means of use for all users, identical whenever possible, equivalent where not. Avoid segregating or stigmatizing any user. Make provisions for privacy, security, and safety equally available to all users. And make the design appealing to all the users. For example, in this picture, we can see an automatic doors in a shopping center. Doors that open automatically without the need of physical effort. Everyone can enter very easily, whether it's a person with a mobility impairment or, for example, an elderly person with a mobility difficulty. The second principle is the flexibility in use. The guidelines are provide choice in methods of use, accommodate right or left-handed access and use, facilitate the user's accuracy and precision, provide adaptability to the user's place. As we can see in the picture, one very simple example is scissors designed for right or left-handed user. For the third principle, simple and intuitive use, the guidelines are: eliminate unnecessary complexity, be consistent with user expectations and intuition, accommodate a wide range of literacy and language skills, arrange information consistent with its importance, and provide effective prompting and feedback during and after task completion. For example, a smartphone application with very clear icons and a minimalist interface, in which the main functions are very easy to understand without the need of very complex instructions, allowing, for example, elderly people or also inexperienced users to use different tools. Regarding the fourth principle, perceptible information, the guidelines are to use different channels, different modes, so pictorial, verbal, and tactile for redundant presentation of essential information, maximizing the legibility of essential information, and differentiate the elements and the way in which they can be described, provide compatibility with a variety of techniques. Like, for example, a wayfinding system that uses both visual symbols and tactile signs allow all the people to understand and easily move and navigate in a space, for example, an airport or a train station. The fifth principle is tolerance for error. The guidelines are: arrange elements to minimize hazards and errors, and provide warning of hazards, provide fail-safe features, and discourage unconscious actions. For example, an undo feature in a software that allows user to correct their mistake in a very easy way, or an online payment platform that allow two-steps confirmation action before proceeding. For example, asking the user to confirm the payment before completing it. Let's go to the principle number six, that is low physical effort, as we see before. The guidelines are: allow user to maintain a neutral body position, use reasonable operating forces, minimize repetitive actions, minimize sustained physical effort. For example, an ergonomically designed door handle that can be easily pushed or pulled without effort, like a lever handle, or as we can see also in the first principle, an automatic door that opens automatically is really useful for people, for example, handling some bags, as well as people with mobility difficulties. The last principle is size and space for approach and use. The guidelines provided from the Universal Design Center are: provide a clear line of sight to important elements for any seated or standing users, make a reach to all components comfortable for any seated or standing user, accommodate variation in hand and grip size, and provide adequate space for the use of assistive devices or personal assistance. An example is, for example, a large corridor in a public space allow person, for example, in wheelchair to move easily, or for example, two people walking together, like for example, an elderly person with a caregiver. The principle also consider, as we can see in the picture, the size and the space provided for counters, height of the tables, and different devices to ensure the accessibility for people at various heights, and as well as people, for example, using wheelchairs. the seven principles of universal design are really useful, not only as guidelines for creating spaces and products, as I said before, but also a vision for fostering an inclusive society where everyone, regardless of their physical, sensory or cognitive characteristics, can interact with the space and the world in an equal and fulfilling way. These principles are also very important for the communicability of universal design, that is really crucial to promote its wider adoption. It's necessary to clarify the concept, offer more comprehensive resources for all the designers in all the design field, and understanding of the which are the information that designers will find useful to operate with the universal design approach and to with its principles. So, in fact, the designers need the precise information that provides a clear definition of design problems, design solutions, design models, that can help them to address very specific and technical problems within different contexts. So the book that that you can see in the slide, that is Universal Design Creating Inclusive Environments, identify four type of informations: goals to define the total scope of the concept, guidelines, strategies to suggest potential approaches to meet the guidelines, and some best practices to provide a practical application, like for example, a technical solution that designers can use. Okay, so I'm going to finish with my presentation with this slide. Just a few things about the goals. This reference that I told you before, Universal Design, Creating Inclusive Environments, identifies eight main goals, body fit, comfort, awareness, understanding, wellness, social integration, personalization, and cultural appropriateness. So those goals are related to the purpose to improve human performance, health, and social participation. And the first four goals are oriented to human performance. Human performance is the ability of people to complete activities and tasks. And the other goals from 5 to 8 are address more the social participation outcomes. And the goal number 5, wellness, is a bridge goal that addresses both human performance and social participation. Thank you very much for listening. I just leave here a few references and resources.